music director Guy for just arranging this beautiful music to set the tone, help us take a few deep breaths as we settle into the beauty of Christmas Eve. So first, we're going to have the lighting of the apple wreath. I invite John and Zach to come up and their prayers.
We light these candles in hope and expectation.
Jesus, light the world.
And Mary gave birth to her firstborn son, and wrapped him in bandage of cloth, and laid him in a manger, because there was no place in the guest room. Let us pray. Emmanuel, God with us, the time is now. You are here. We light every candle on our wreath because your presence glows among us. However this night finds us, filled with joy or touched by grief, alone or in the company of our loved ones, you are with us and you will never leave. And so we sing with the angels.
Hallelujah and Amen.
And a couple of housekeeping notes. If you don't, we ran off extra bulletins, so if you don't have one yet, raise your hand so that the ushers can get one to you. And also, if you are hard of hearing, we have printed, we have a sermon printed in the back, and you can pick it up from the ushers as well. And so now we pray, as we pray every Sunday morning, the hospitality blessing found on this cue card in front of you. Holy Spirit,
help us to recognize each person as an individual set by you.
magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
And
word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Psalm for tonight is Psalm 96. We will pray this responsively by the whole verse. Sing to the Lord a new song. Sing to the Lord all the whole earth.
Sing to the Lord and bless his name. Proclaim the good news of salvation from day to day.
Declare his glory among the nations and his wonders among all peoples.
Great is the Lord, and greatly to be praised. He is more to be feared than all gods.
As for all the gods of the nations, they are but idols, but it is the Lord who made the heavens. Ascribe to the Lord honor and power.
Ascribe to the Lord and honor to his name. Bring offerings and come into his courts.
Worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. Let the whole earth tremble before him. Let the field be joyful and all that is therein.
Then shall all the trees of the Lord shout for joy before the Lord when he comes to judge the earth.
He will judge the world with righteousness and the prophets with his truth. A reading from the letter to Titus. For the grace of God has appeared, bringing salvation to all, training us to renounce impiety and worldly passions, and in the presence
age to live lives that are self-controlled, upright, and godly, while we wait for the blessed hope and the manifestation of the glory of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ. He it is who gave himself for us, that he might redeem us from all iniquity and purify for himself a people of his own who are zealous for good deeds. The word of the Lord.
Glorifying and praising God for all they have heard and seen, as it happened. It might just be your imagination. You wait, and the space between clouds grow brighter. Then the sky develops layers of grays and reds, oranges and blues and gold. Then this one spot starts shining bright and fierce. The first part of the sunrise feels deliberate and slow, as if the sun has charted a path and is still checking it twice. Partway through, it seems more certain of, or at least more committed to, its course. All of a sudden, everything changes. Once the sun is so bright we have to look away, it can be easy to forget how long we had to wait for that light. This morning, it was the seventh Sunday of Advent, and now it's Christmas Eve. In between these services, the altar guild did their magic and switched all the purple hangings to white and gold. And so we moved from 6 weeks of preparation and reflection to 12 days of celebration. As we do, it's important to remember that moving from one season to another isn't like flipping a switch. Church seasons are part of a continuous whole. They're connected. They build on each other. Similar to the way we experience the seasons in Texas, in practice, the transition isn't as neat and clear-cut as we might expect or hope. Advent is all about preparing for these kinds of transitions. This year, we celebrated an extended Advent. Starting at 3 weeks earlier meant that readings we normally associate with endings were repurposed to help us recognize beginnings. This encouraged us to think about how we already hold in our hands the threads for weaving together the new thing we're dreaming of, even if we can't quite fully picture what it's going to look like. Since everything we need is here, Advent is about resting our eyes and taking more than a few deep breaths. This helps us regain the bandwidth to see clearly. Since we are already where we need to be, in Advent we can focus on recentering ourselves and God. This puts us in a better place to notice what was hidden before. Perhaps our goal was to shift our perspective, moving from 500 feet to 20,000 feet, or vice versa. And rather than going on at a question straight on, maybe we reframe that question or the context in which it was asked. We might have tried to hit pause on that spiral or pulled ourselves back from going further down that rabbit hole. We could have turned to face a different direction, aiming ourselves closer to the mark, or tuned our eyes or ears or nose or taste or touch to sense something we wouldn't have noticed before. What seems like a small adjustment can end up making a big difference. Easier said than done, I know. Even on a good day, I have to remind myself multiple times to open the daily prayer app first instead of Instagram. And always, the shadow of death hangs over us. It threatens to dull our senses and limit our perspective. Scholar Robert Alter's translation of today's familiar verses from the book of the prophet Isaiah helps us see that by translating darkness as the land of death's shadow the second time it comes up. The people walking in darkness, and then those dwelling in the land of death's shadow. That is a particular kind of darkness. When we live in the shadow of death, the possibility of death and the threat of death will affect how we behave and how we try to regulate other people's behaviors. Think about how we take our shoes off at the airport and why we a law that was just passed here in Texas, allowing troopers with DPS and sheriff's deputies to arrest those they judge to have illegally entered the country. Think about debates in New York and other states that have right to shelter laws, about how much hospitality they can offer strangers. Think about laws passed during the height of the pandemic around rent and student debt and childcare that helped many stay afloat, barely. The shadow of death gives rise to fears about scarcity, to debates about who is deserving of limited resources, about the kind of rights and the kind of dignity every human being fundamentally deserves. In ways we are aware and unaware, death casts a shadow on everything that happens around us and on everything we allow to happen, on everything we do. In the land of death's shadow, fears about security and scarcity reign supreme. How do we fight the forces of death? How do we contend with the shadow of death? It would be nice if God showed up to fight death at the head of an army of angels with swords blazing and trumpets blaring. Many try to overcome the shadow of death during the long dark nights in December with bright lights and giant inflatable figures, with loud music and even louder cheer. This year, I've seen Santa in a helicopter, R2-D2 in an X-Wing, and a reindeer as tall as a house. No joke. And at the same time, there is conflict and fighting and death in the land of the Holy One. Archbishop Hossam of the Episcopal Church of Jerusalem and Middle East has asked the churches in his diocese to celebrate Christmas without the usual festivities, without the commercial aspects of lights and processions. He asked them to focus on prayer, liturgy, and worship, to celebrate this Christmas as if it was the first Christmas, because, quote, if you think about it, during the first Christmas, the first incarnation of Jesus, besides his own birth, there was nothing joyful in Christmas. He also asks Christians around the world to reflect on the conditions in that land at the time of Jesus' birth. Quote, in doing so, we will find that they were no better than the circumstances here today. During the first Christmas, the Holy Family had difficulty finding a place for their son's birth. There was the killing of children, there was military occupation, and there was the Holy Family becoming displaced refugees. This isn't something that only happened back then. These are the images coming to us from Gaza, from Bethlehem. This isn't something that only happens over there. Right here, right now, women and trans folks are fleeing across state lines to meet their healthcare needs. Households are fleeing ever-widening flood zones and fire zones and droughts and rising sea levels. There are those who play on fears about scarcity and security to build up more money and more power for themselves. We, all of us, are all the poorer when the shadow of death stifles the light that comes from desiring love and life for everyone. People like Mary and Joseph were subject to decisions made with very little compassion and grace. They were subject to decrees made by people with very little awareness of the effect this will have on those without the money and resources to get around them or to soften their impact. Son of God and the Son of Mary. He's got a mother who willingly made herself a home for the power of the Most High, a mother who believed that God saw more in her than the rest of the world would in a young girl from a poor family. She believed the angel Gabriel when he said, "Nothing will be impossible with God." She believed that the world can and will be different with God's help. So she sang Jesus' lullabies about a world that is about to turn. And he grew up to proclaim that he came to fulfill the good news and the liberation proclaimed by Isaiah. She believed the shepherds, unlikely messengers as they may appear. And she treasured the words they shared with her and continued to ponder them in her heart. Yes, God was on his side, and so was his mother. And so were all the generations that came before him in the house of David. Their words and witnesses showed us where to look, gave us the hope to keep waiting, to keep looking. After the death and resurrection of Jesus, death can no longer cast a shadow over us. God is with us, and when we are a part of the body of Christ, none of us has to face the shadow of death by ourselves. Not unless we choose to, not unless we forget we don't have to. Christmas isn't a searchlight that suddenly shines on us. Christmas is waiting for the sun to rise. It's about staring at the horizon in faith and hope, looking for the spot that's growing just a little bit brighter, for the reds and oranges, blues and golds, against the background of the shadow of death. We look toward people whose life and love are piercing through the darkness, proclaiming the presence of the sun just beyond the horizon. Against fears about security, we stand firm in the belief that endless peace will only come from God's justice and righteousness. Against fears about scarcity, we act out of the belief that the grace of God has appeared, bringing salvation to all. It's okay if we don't fully know what this looks like. It's okay if the shadow of death still weighs heavy on us. It's okay as long as we keep looking for those hints of color, as long as we keep turning toward this tiny sliver of sun. We don't have to understand and do everything right away. We don't have to do it alone. Every year on this night, we look toward Jesus and ponder the word of God. Every year we gather and give thanks for and praise and share the warmth of life and love we have glimpsed and experienced. Every year we tell these stories again to remember that God has already defeated the forces of death. God has already overcome death's shadow. For the sun has already risen. Thanks be to God, and Merry Christmas.
Wondrous God, whose love was made flesh on this holy night, hear us as we pray, and take to your heart all of our longings and things. Wonderful Counselor, give wisdom to the leaders of the nations, that they might guide us to peace. Bring an end to war in the Middle East, Ukraine, and throughout Africa. Mighty God, make your church to be one in spirit and truth, strong with courage and rich with grace. Help us to tell the sweet good news of your love in all we say and do, and especially as we reach toward each other.
Amen. May your church be united in serving the world.
Everlasting Father, help all who suffer to remember your love. Bring relief and strength to endure to those who are lonely, dying, and in pain. Help especially those with chronic diseases, cancer, and other illnesses stay near to those in prison.
Everlasting Father, may the day come soon when our tears are wiped away by your hand.
Prince of Peace, help us to bring an end to all poverty and racism, which keep your children hungry and powerless. Grant that your peace would rule in our hearts and in our lives.
Prince of Peace, may you come soon to reign among us.
Child of David's throne, may all who live with you in glory help us, by their example and prayer, to find our way home. Give us especially the courage of Isaiah, of Mary, and of John. Grant us the wonder of the shepherds and magi. Fill us with the songs of the angels. Thank you for the miracle and grace of Christmas. May we be true all the year long to its call to believe the impossible and to make our humble humanity the place of your dwelling. Hear us, we pray, and take to your heart all of our longing and things through Jesus the Christ, through the Spirit.
Amen.
Peace of the Lord be always with you. Connections card, ask the ushers for one, or if you see, look at the one in your pews, and our brother Joseph with fatherly care. Jesus came among us as a baby, humbly born, cradled beside the beasts and warmed by their breath. Human as we are, in need of human love. Yet kings bowed down before him, bringing gifts, and emperors were troubled by his reign. This child in whom all the fullness of God was pleased to dwell. This word of God made flesh and full of grace was sent to deliver us from our sin, from the power of evil and the fear of death. As a servant, Jesus emptied himself of might upon the cross, and as the risen anointed one is enthroned at God's right hand, to bring mercy and justice to all the earth at the end of days. And so, rejoicing in all God has done for us, we proclaim the mystery of our faith.
Christ is God, Christ is risen, Christ will come again.
Holy God, as you visit us in the birth of Jesus, visit us now by the power of your Spirit in these creatures of bread and wine, making them for us the body and blood of Christ, the banquet of heaven here on earth. As we remember how Jesus took bread and blessed and broke it and gave it to his friend, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." And after supper, took a cup of wine and blessed and gave it to them, saying, "Drink this, all of you. This cup is the new covenant in my blood, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this for the remembrance of me." Blessed God, shed your grace brighter than starlight on us, that we may bear your good tidings to all and renew the weary world in your name. In the name of Emmanuel, God with us, to whom we give honor and glory and joy, now and forever. Amen. And now, as our Christ, Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses,
and the blessing